The next topic in unit number 1 is national income. In simple words, national income is the total market value of all final goods and services produced in the economy during a given year. Now let's understand a definition of national income. The definition of national income. According to Simon Kuznets, national income is defined as the net output of commodities and services. That means the total output, total goods and services produced during the given year from the country's productive system. That means from the producers in the hands of ultimate consumers. That means from the producers ultimately to the consumers. We have already studied in our lower grades about different methods of measuring national income. These are output method, income method, and expenditure method. Let's understand each of these methods. The first one is output method. It is also called as product method or value added method. This method measures the output of the country. Under this method, national income is calculated by adding the value of final goods and services produced by different sectors such as agriculture, industry, trade, commerce in a country during a given year. The next method is income method. Under this method, the income of all the factors of productions are added together. So the factor income are in the form of rent, wages, interest and profits. However, transfer payments like gifts, subsidies, pension, they are to be deducted from the total of factor incomes. The last method is expenditure method. It is also called as outlay method. In this method, all the expenditures which are incurred by households, firms and government are added up together. This method is not as popular as the previous ones. Now let's understand concepts of national income. The very first concept of national income is gross domestic product, that is GDP MP. Now this MP stands for market price. So students, let me tell you that there are certain concepts of national income which are measured at market price, while there are certain other concepts of national income which are measured at factor cost, that is FC. So here the very first concept is measured by using MP, that is GDP at market price. So let's understand what is this. GDP, what is GDP? GDP is the total money value of all the final goods and services. That is all the goods and services that is produced in terms of money within the total territory, that is the domestic territory of a country in a given year. So here domestic territory is the key word. It is important because this shows that whatever is produced, it is within the country and this is measured at market price. So the formula for measuring is GDP is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. That is GDP is the total value of consumption, investment expenditure, government expenditure, and X minus M stands for export minus import. The next concept of national income is gross national product at market price, that is GNP MP. GNP refers to the total market value of all the final goods and services produced during a given year in an economy plus net income from abroad. So here, when I say final goods and services, by this I mean what? All the finished goods and services which is ready for consumption to all the people. It does not include raw material or semi-finished goods. Okay, so final goods and services are those goods which can be directly consumed. and there is no requirement of further production process, so which is produced during a given year in an economy, plus net income from abroad. So here the addition here is what? Net income from abroad is the addition. So see the formula, GNP MP is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M plus R minus P. As I told you, the addition here is what? Net income from abroad. R minus P stands for net income from abroad. While C, that was consumption expenditure, investment expenditure, government expenditure. X minus M, export minus import. This entire thing is nothing but our GDP that we just studied in our last concept, right? So you can either write this way, the formula can either be written this way. Only addition here is R minus P. Or what you can write is GDP plus R minus P. Why GDP? Because this entire thing here is nothing but GDP, which we just studied in our last concept. Okay, so only addition is R minus P. So what you can simply write GNP MP is GDP plus R minus P. As I told you, R minus P stands for net factor income from abroad. Okay, so here R. So in this R minus P, R stands for what? Income receipts from abroad. For example, suppose there is a company, it's an Indian based company, which is having its branch in US. So whatever the earning the branch does in US, okay, certain share of profit will come back to India, right? So that is nothing but R, that is income receipts from abroad. R I country ke andar, receipt matlab aana, right? Coming back to the domestic country. While P here stands for income paid abroad. So this is vice versa. So here P means what? Whatever money foreign residents will earn because of their investment in our country. Okay, so P is income paid abroad. That is, the money is going to the foreign residents. It is not our money. It is going to the foreign residents because they have invested in our country. The next concept is net national product, that is NNP at market price. It refers to the net, that is total value, money value of all the final goods and services produced by a country, including the net income from abroad during a given year. I repeat, it includes the total money value of all final goods and services produced by a country, including the net income from abroad during a given year. If you read till here carefully, you will understand it is same as GNP, which we did in the last concept. That is, the second concept was what? GNP, correct? So that is why in the formula we have written here GNP. Okay, only addition here is that further it is obtained by deducting, that is, they are minusing the value of depreciation from GNP, correct? So NNP at MP, in the formula, how will you write? GNP minus depreciation from GNP, okay? So depreciation means what? The value of assets, okay, goes on reducing after using it for a certain period of time, right? So machines used in the production need to be replaced in the future. Okay, why? Because we are constantly using it. So it becomes a little old, right? And sometimes need repair as well. Okay, so if it becomes, also it becomes out of, out of order, because new machines need to be replaced. So that is depreciation cost. Fine. The next concept here is NDP at market price. Okay, that is net domestic product at market price. So this is the same as the earlier concept, that is NNP at market price. Okay, the only difference here is that here we are considering GNP, okay, and in net domestic product we are considering GDP, correct? Because it is domestic mentioned here. So GDP minus depreciation. Okay, so it is obtained by deducting the value of depreciation from GDP because it is gross domestic product, and here it was gross national product. That is why we deducted the value of depreciation from GNP. That is the only difference. Rest these two formula, these two concepts are very similar. The fifth concept is gross domestic product at factor cost. Okay, this is what GDP at factor cost. You remember the very first concept we did was GDP at market price. Okay, this is GDP at factor cost. I told you there are certain concepts which are measured by using market price, and there are certain concepts which are measured by using factor cost. So this is one of the concepts. So what is it? It refers to the sum of factors income. When we say factor cost, that is we are including factors income. What income? Income that is payment in the form of rent, wages, interest and profits, which is generated within the domestic territory, because we are talking of GDP, domestic. So within the domestic territory of a country in a given year. Okay, so it is calculated by deducting indirect taxes and adding subsidies. To what? To GDP MP. As I told you, this is the very first concept which we have done. GDP MP. Okay. So I repeat, GDP FC. What is the formula? Gross domestic product at factor cost is GDP MP, which we did. That is the very first concept. Minus indirect taxes and adding subsidies. Next concept is GNP FC. That is gross national product at factor cost. This is similar to the fifth one. Okay, the only difference here is the fifth concept was domestic and the sixth concept is national. So GNPFC is obtained by deducting indirect taxes and adding subsidies. But kisme, to what? To GNPMP. That is gross national product at market price. This is the second concept that we have done, if you remember. The first concept which we did was GDPMP, and the second concept which we did was GNPMP. Okay, so these two, that is the fifth and the sixth one, the both concepts are same. If you look, see, minus indirect taxes plus subsidies. Here also it is minus indirect taxes plus subsidies. Only difference here is this is GDPMP, because obviously you are talking about GDP at factor cost, and here it is GNP MP because you're talking about GNP at factor cost. Okay. The next concept is net domestic product at factor cost, that is NDP at factor cost. So if you notice, look at the formula, it is very much similar. Okay, it is obtained, that is NDP FC is obtained by deducting indirect taxes and adding subsidies to what? To NDP MP. This concept already we have done. Okay, NDP, why? Because we are talking about net domestic product. Okay, and MP we have already done, market at market price. Eighth concept is net national product at factor cost. Okay, also called as national income. Now here NNPFC. Now this is obtained by deducting indirect taxes and adding subsidies to what? To NNP. Because the concept says what? What are we defining? We're defining NNP. So to NNP at market price. Okay, this concept also we have already done. So NNPFC is obtained by deducting indirect taxes and adding subsidies to NNP at market price. Okay, why we are writing market price? Because we are defining FC, we are defining in terms of factor cost, factor income. The next concept of national income is national income at current price. Now this concept is also called as nominal national income. So what is it? It is the total money value of all the goods and services produced in the economy multiplied with the prices prevailing in the current year. that is whatever is the current price that they are multiplying with it. It also refers to NNP calculated on the basis of current market price. Okay, so here the keyword is current market price, that is the existing prices. The very next concept is national income at constant price. This is also called as real national income. So it is the money value of all the goods and services produced in the current year, estimated on the basis of prices prevailing in the base year. This year is a constant year used for comparison. It refers to NNP calculated on the basis of constant prices of a certain base year. So this means what? Now basically base year means what? For example, if I want to calculate a particular national income of a particular year, so that I will that year will be considered as a base year. For example, the year 2010. So the prices, okay, which has to be constant, okay, so constant prices of a particular year, that is 2010, that is this concept, national income at constant price. And if I want to know, calculate for the current, right now, so we fall into this category, that is national income at current price, because we are calculating the existing prevailing means existing prices. Next concept is personal income, PI. Personal income is the total money value received by all individuals or households during a year. It also this includes income earned by the people in the form of wages as well as salaries, as well as it also includes transfer payments from government. Now students, transfer payments from government means what? It is the payment which the government makes, which the government gives to the people, but in return it does not take anything. So example of transfer payments include old age pensions. It also includes unemployment benefits, which is given in certain countries. Okay, so the formula of personal income is national income plus transfer payments minus undistributed profits of corporate sector. Undistributed profits of corporate sector means, now a corporate firm earns profit. Now when this corporate firm does not distribute this profit among its shareholders in the form of dividends, this means undistributed profits of corporate sector, minus the corporation tax as well as minus the social security contributions. Social security contribution means payments, that is compulsory payments which we citizens of the country give to the government. Why? Because we expect that in future we will get some special benefit of those payments that we have made. For example, this includes taxes. Next concept is disposable personal income, DPI. Now this concept is simple. It is the sum of consumption and savings of the individuals. So it is the total income of individuals minus the direct taxes. That means whatever is there in the hands of people for spending, that is disposable income or disposable personal income. Now what is the formula for this? The formula is DPI, that is disposable personal income, is the total of, that is sum of consumption as well as savings, C and S. Or you can also write this as DPI is equal to personal income minus the direct taxes. That is whatever remains in the hands of people after paying their taxes, that is disposable income. The next concept is personal savings. Personal savings is the difference between disposable income and personal consumption expenditure. That means whatever is our income, and from that income whatever we spend, okay, after that whatever remains we will save, right? This is personal savings. The last concept is per capita income, that is PCI. Per capita income is always obtained by dividing national income by the population. It is also called as the average income of the people in the country. As you can see in the formula, PCI is equal to NI, that is national income, divided by the population. The next topic is importance of national income analysis. So let's understand why this topic of national income is important and where all it can help us to understand our economy better. Importance of national income analysis. As you can see in this slide, there are 9 points that show why national income analysis is important. Let's understand each of these 9 points in detail. The very first point of importance of national income analysis is measures economic performance of country. That is, national income helps to measure the performance of every country. Now, for example, now if we want to know what is the standard performance of any country, then obviously we will look at the country's growth rate. We will look at the country's national output, right? So we will compare different countries on the basis of how they are ranked in terms of their GDP, in terms of their size, in terms of their per capita income. So here I have an example for you. Now, this table here shows GDP growth rates. Okay, so here we have divided the table into 3 parts. One is the list of countries, second is the GDP growth rate in terms of percentage, and the third is the year. So here we are considering only 2019, okay, and the countries here are US, China and India. So if you look at the table carefully, you will understand that as per the year 2019, China tops the list. Okay, in terms of GDP growth rate, that is, it has 6.1% of GDP growth rate. So this is how we understood, through this example, we have understood that it is economic performance of China is much better than the other countries. So why was this possible? Because we have understood the concept of national income. We have understood the concept of GDP. The next point here is to compare standards of living. So national income concept is also important because we can compare the standards of living of different countries. Now, as we know students, in order to compare the standards of living, one important concept here is to understand PCI, that is per capita income. So if we understand per capita income only, then we can compare the standards of living of different countries. Okay, so it is said that per capita income also acts as a very important tool, measurement tool, so as to compare the inequality in terms of income in a country. So if you can see in this table, the table shows GDP per capita, that is the per capita income. So here we are taking in terms of US dollar, because dollar, why? Because dollar is the vehicle currency, as you know. Again, there are 3 columns, country, that is the list of countries. Here in this middle column shows the per capita income, GDP per capita in terms of US dollar, and the year. Again, the year we will take constant, that is year we will take 2019. So if you look at the table carefully, you will understand that US tops the list in terms of per capita income. Okay, so it shows that US standard of living is much better than the other countries in the year 2019. So this comparison was only possible, why? Because we have got the data of per capita income of different countries, which we understood and which we studied in this topic of national income analysis. The next importance of national income analysis is the sectoral contribution. Now, as we know students, there are 3 main sectors in our economy. That is, primary sector consisting of agriculture, forestry and fishing. Second sector is secondary sector, that includes industry. And third sector is the tertiary sector, that includes services. That is the service sector. Now students, each of these three sectors, primary, secondary, and tertiary, contribute to the national income analysis. Now, students, analysis of national income also shows how much are all of these three sectors contributing to the national income, and it also shows how their percentage trend have changed throughout the years. For example, the contribution of industrial sector would not be the same in the year 1950 as it is now, right? Also, the contribution of service sector to GDP or to our economy would not be the same as it was in the year 1950. So, for example, I can show you here the contribution of the primary sector, that is agriculture, forestry, and fishing, as per the year 2018 and 19 is 16.1. While if you compare the same sector in the year 2009-10 to 2013-14, it was 18%. So this shows what the contribution of agricultural sector, that is primary sector, to our GDP has reduced. Why this is reduced? But obvious reasons, people are now shifting more towards working in industries and working in the service sector. Same way, students, we can compare each of the other two sectors also, that is industrial sector, the contribution in the year 2018-19 is 29%, while the contribution of service sector in the year 2018 and 19 is 54%. So this shows what one thing, that is we can compare each of the three sectors, which shows that service sector contribution is the highest out of all the three sectors, that is 54%, followed by industrial sector, that is 29%. So this shows that through this data and through understanding the national income concept, we have now understood what is the percentage-wise contribution of each sector and how it is changed throughout the years. The next point is measurement of economic welfare. Now, students, our concept of national income or national income which is allotted in every country also shows what is the level of that particular country's economic welfare. For example, if a country's national income, okay, a large part of the national income is allotted only for defense production, while a very, very small part of national income or the money is utilized for education and health services, this shows what? A negative growth, a negative trend in terms of economic welfare of that particular country, right? Because as far as possible, it should be in terms of the country's performance or as per the situation. But obviously, a very large part should not be allocated to only one sector. As far as possible, it should be equalized so that the growth in all the sectors are almost the same. The next point is changes in price level. Students, we have already done a concept, that is GDP or GNP, which is measured at current and constant price. I hope you all remember that concept. Now, if we utilize this concept, if the policymakers or economists utilize this concept, then they will understand how the price level have changed throughout the years. And through this, they will be able to forecast the future inflationary situations in our country or any deflationary situation in our country. So based on the concept of GNP or GDP at constant and current prices. So thus this shows the importance of national income. The next point is business forecast. So understanding about national income also helps the businesses to know about what will be the future changes in their business activities. So for example, if any businessman wants to set up a new business in some another country, then obviously they will require a knowledge of that particular country's market trend. What is that country's level of national income, growth rate, and accordingly the businessman will take an effective decision, right? So this is only possible after understanding these certain concepts. Because if they don't know about this, then their business will go into losses. So it is very important for the businessmen as well. The next point is global income distribution. Now, the data that the policymakers receive about every country in terms of national income, that will be utilized for them to understand and to get the knowledge about what is the income distribution globally. What kind of income distribution is globally, whether it is equal income distribution or unequal distribution of income. Now, there is one more concept called as HDI. HDI is Human Development Index. Now, this index, HDI, it calculates the country's development, or it measures the country's development in terms of three indicators. That is life expectancy at birth, average education level, and third is the standard of living. So this HDI is used by various international development agencies, okay, through which they can then implement various programs, various policies to reduce the inequalities that are in different countries. Next point is economic planning and policies. Now, most of the governments of various countries also use national income data so as to frame their long-term plans and medium-term policies as that is suitable to the country. For example, India has adopted 5-year plans so as to improve its growth of national income. Also, government implements various initiatives, for example, financial inclusion, so as to include even the poor people in terms of financial literacy. Second is Make in India campaign. Third is MG Narega, so that is Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, which provides guaranteed rural employment to the unskilled labor force. So all these certain initiatives are taken by the government so as to improve the economic growth and development. And the last point is budgetary policy. So national income accounting also helps the government to prepare its budgets and make necessary changes in terms of taxation rates or borrowing policies. The next subtopic under national income is green GNP and green NNP concepts. Introduction. Conventional measurements of national income, that means traditional measurements of national income. That is, national income was traditionally measured by using concepts like GDP and GNP that we have already studied. But these two concepts have certain limitations. What is the limitation? The limitation is that it does not reflect environmental performance. That is, it does not show what is its effect on the environment and what is its effect, that is the impact on human welfare. So conventional GNP ignores, that means traditional concept of GNP ignores, that is, it does not consider two things. One is that environmental degradation, for example, pollution damage. For example, if there is a factory which is contributing towards the production, that is contributing towards the national income, but at the same time causing lot of pollution. So this pollution damage, that is to the environment, that is not considered under the traditional concept of GNP. Secondly, it also does not consider the depletion of natural resources. So if the industry is contributing towards the national income through production, it is also utilizing more and more of resources which is naturally available. So that is also not considered. If the traditional concept of GNP included environmental performance, that is, if it gave importance to environment, then it would become a new concept called as green GNP. So what is green GNP? Green GNP is an economic and environmental accounting framework which measures the national wealth, that is the wealth of the nation, by accounting for, that is by calculating and including exhaustion of natural resources, that is depletion of natural resources. It calculates the how much natural resources have been depleted and how much it's remaining, as well as degradation to the environment and investment in environment support. Investment in environment support means what? All the plans, all the policies to be implemented which promotes the good health of the environment. For example, tree plantation policy. Definition. Green GNP is GNP which would attain sustainable use of natural environment. That means to utilize natural environment such that not only the present generation but also the future generations can enjoy, and equitable distribution of benefits of development. That means whatever benefits the development, through development we are getting, that is how the economy is growing, that benefit must be enjoyed by everyone, not only the rich people but also the poor people. The formula to calculate green GNP is GNP minus cost of environmental degradation and depletion of natural resources. That means what? The amount, the total amount of GNP, from the total amount of GNP, we are subtracting the amount that the damage that it has caused to the environment. So for example, there is pollution damage that is caused. So whatever the damage is there, that we are subtracting from the GNP. And this is how we will get our green GNP. Now let's understand the characteristics of green GNP concept. The very first one is that an increase in the environmental degradation will obviously lead to a decrease in the green GNP. This means that if any industry is causing pollution to the environment, then automatically its amount of green GNP will reduce. Second characteristic is sustainable economic development. This means that the concept gives importance to sustainable economic development. Not only economic development, but sustainable economic development. That means development which will not cause any environmental damage or any pollution damage, as well as depletion of natural resources. The third one is that green GNP concept also acts as a measure of equitable distribution of income. So it sees to it that the benefits of income or the distribution of income is equally done among all the sections of the society. The next characteristic of green GNP is economic welfare. Green GNP promotes economic welfare for long period of time. Economic welfare means prosperity as well as the standard of living of the economy. The fifth characteristic of green GNP is that green GNP is very much different from the traditional GNP concept. Yes, it is rightly said. Why? We all know that is because it does not include the component that is environmental protection, sustainability, as well as the welfare of all the human beings. And the last characteristic is that green GNP has given lot of importance to environmental performance, as well as what will be its impact, what will be its effect on the welfare of the human beings. The next concept here comes is about green NNP. The formula for NNP is GNP minus depreciation of human capital. Depreciation of human capital means depreciation of physical assets like machinery. Conventional GNP and NNP concepts, that is the traditional GNP and NNP concepts, only considered man-made capital but ignored natural capital. So man-made capital is physical assets and it did not include natural capital, that is environment. And therefore, we have a new concept here called as green NNP. The formula for green NNP is GNP minus depreciation of human capital minus depreciation of natural capital. So here we are depreciating, that is subtracting human capital as well as natural capital from the concept of GNP, and thus we will get our concept, that is green NNP. Further, in the same formula, you can also substitute depreciation of human capital by writing depreciation of physical assets. On the other hand, you can substitute depreciation of natural capital with depreciation of environmental assets. Thus, students, today economists also consider green NNP rather than traditional NNP concept as a still better as well as a real indicator of economic welfare. Today, green national accounting is considered to be better indicators of economic welfare. The next question is relationship between national income and economic welfare. Whenever we talk about welfare in economics, it simply means economic welfare. Economic welfare shows the level of prosperity as well as the standard of living of either an individual or a group of the people in the economy. Economic welfare also means utility gained, that means the satisfaction gained through achieving, that is utilizing all the material goods as well as the services. So that is the reason our government is all the time in the process of improving our economic welfare. Do you know, students, how? Can you give me certain examples for this? The relationship between national income and economic welfare can be understood under certain conditions. Let's understand which are these conditions. The very first one is change in size of national income. Now, the changes in the size of national income can either have a positive or a negative impact on economic welfare. For example, if the size of national income increases, people will earn more income and therefore they will consume more goods and services, thus leading to an increase in economic welfare. This shows a positive impact on economic welfare. On the other hand, if the size of national income falls, people earn less income and thus they consume less goods and services. This further leads to a fall in the economic welfare, thus showing a negative impact on economic welfare. The second condition is change in prices. The value of national income changes because of change in prices. For example, if the prices rise along with the rise in national income, but there is no increase in output, then this will result in fall in the economic welfare of the people. This is because people's purchasing power also falls. That is, nobody is purchasing goods and services. The next condition is per capita income. If the national income and population increases at the same rate, then the per capita income will remain the same. So, in such a situation, even though there is an increase in the national income, economic welfare will not increase. So there will be no increase in economic welfare. The next point comes here is spending pattern, that is the way the people spend their income or money. For example, if there is an increase in the national income and if people spend their increased income on necessities like food, housing, then the economic welfare will increase. On the other hand, if the national income increases, but people spend their increased income on buying luxury goods, then the economic welfare will decrease. The next condition here is about production pattern. Now, if the industries are producing all the essential goods, then it will result in increase in income, thus further leading to increase in economic welfare. On the other hand, if the industries are producing luxury goods or harmful goods like liquor or cigarettes, and if it leads to increase in national income, then overall it will result in fall in economic welfare of the people. The last point comes here is about income distribution. If there is an equal distribution of income, then it will result in increase in economic welfare. On the other hand, if there is unequal income distribution, it leads to a fall in the economic welfare. So thus, students, an increase in national income is not a sufficient condition for knowing the increase in welfare of the people. It is equally important that there must be equal and equitable distribution of national income as well. So if the increase in national income comes along with unequal distribution of income, then economic welfare has to reduce.